Welcome to my talk. I'm Yuri Gogotsi. I'm professor of material science at Drexel University. And today I'm going to talk to you about my travel in the world of science, also my travel from Ukraine, from work on corrosion of structural ceramics, what some of you may be able to read on the cover of this book, through many countries, many years, to nanotechnology research, to discovery of new materials, which are being researched nowadays by thousands of scientists over the entire world here. But first, I know we have a diverse audience here. Let me talk about my profession, about material science. You don't need to be an expert in material science engineering to know that the world is made of materials. From the Stone Age to the Silicon Age, humans have crafted tools by carving them out of first bone, stone, then making them out of bronze, iron. Today, we live in the silicon world. All our electronic devices are made using silicon chips here. And we are pushing the world even further, building them out of new materials, creating materials atom by atom here. So those are the type of things my research group is doing here. But let's go back, actually, back more than 40 years back to Kyiv, Ukraine, at that time former Soviet Union. I know some of my students today, even by the end of their PhD study, are not decided what to do with their life. But to me, this decision came very early. When I was in high school, I got excited about chemistry. I didn't really need a textbook. I could listen to my chemistry teacher and I would memorize everything. So my father took me to chemistry club and probably starting from eighth grade, I was in this chemistry club doing crazy experiments. I was throwing metallic sodium into pools of water and see how it explodes. I would work with mercury or hydrofluoric acid, something that pretty much graduate students are not allowed to do nowadays in most of university labs. I would work with liquid metals, actually creating metals out of oxides, out of raw materials, at temperatures approaching 5,000 degrees. And, well, it was maybe a little bit dangerous, but it was exciting. And I really loved chemistry. I still do. And naturally, after I graduated from high school, the decision was obvious. I would go to study chemistry, just like most of my friends from the chemistry club. And this is when I met a first major challenge. When I applied to Kyiv University to study chemistry, I was told I was not good enough because I had some mild color blindness. And I was told, no, if you cannot distinguish colors clearly enough, you cannot become a chemist. So what did I do? I didn't stop. I actually went and learned all this like tables for checking on color blindness to memorize them. But by the time I was doing this, I also found that there was a metallurgy department at another university in Kyiv, Kyiv Polytechnic, something dealing with high temperatures, dealing with chemistry, but chemistry at these extreme temperatures I liked before. So what I did, I went to study to Kyiv Polytechnic. I went to study high temperature, working on high performance ceramic materials that were designed for engine things here. It was very exciting, very interesting here. When I graduated, I continued towards PhD. And in 1990, when Gorbachev came and started Perestroika, I was among the first one to go to see the world. I went to Germany. I went afterwards to Japan to see how Japanese make the best functional ceramics. And Japan was exciting experience, and I would recommend everyone who wants to become a scientist, everyone who wants to work at the cutting edge of engineering, to go and explore different countries, different places. In the Soviet Union, I could not really travel much. I could not see the world. As a postdoc, I was able to see the world. I was able to travel here. And actually, Japan was great. I published my first paper in Nature. I made a very important finding. And for scientists, publishing paper in Nature is like for a mountaineer climbing Mount Everest, getting to the very, very top here. But I actually did not feel like in Japan I had enough freedom to do what I want. And this may sound surprising for a guy coming from a very, very restrictive country, Soviet Union. At the time, actually, Ukraine was still part of the Soviet Union when I studied. Japan, not enough freedom. But it's a very traditional country where seniority defines pretty much everything. So I decided to go back to Europe. I went to work in Norway, I went to Germany again, and the time actually came to decide where I wanted to build my career. After traveling around the world, after visiting the United States several times, I actually realized that the best opportunities will be offered to me in the US. And the main reason is that I was looking really for opportunity not just follow someone else's path in research. I want to do something different. I didn't want anyone to tell me what to do. And this is exactly what US academic system offers actually here. As an assistant professor, I would be able to do everything what I wanted as long as I could get funding to do what I wanted here. So what I did, I started to apply for positions. And as you can imagine, and anyone who applied for jobs knows probably, you get rejections. You have to learn to get lots of rejections. But finally, I got an invitation to fly from Europe to the US for an interview at a very good university here. And actually, I did fly there. I went for an interview and I failed it spectacularly. I had no clue what was expected from a professor in the US. And I didn't get discouraged here. What I did, I learned. I succeeded in my next interview. However, I didn't still get an offer. And the reason was because I was in a somewhat different field and the university was looking for someone else. What happened? Actually, a couple of weeks later, I got an email from Professor Selchuk Gucherov from another university, University of Illinois Chicago, where I got my first faculty position, with a question. Yuri, I know you applied elsewhere. Would you be also interested to consider our university? I came, I got a job offer, I moved in Chicago in 96 here and started to work on nanomaterials there. First carbon nanomaterials, making carbon nanotubes, nanoporous carbon, discovering new materials, finding application for those new materials, basically having fun with science, doing discovery science, discovery materials that I wanted to discover here. And in 2000, I moved to Drexel University. After 4 years, what normally takes basically about a decade, I got a full professor position, actually on invitation of same Professor Selchuk Gucherov, who some of you affiliated with Drexel University know has been a very successful Dean of Engineering after he moved from USC to Drexel here. And I've been at Drexel for 20 years now. And a decade ago, we discovered with my colleagues at Drexel University an entirely new family of materials here. And this will be the next thing I'm going to talk about. But before that, I just want to tell to people who may come from other countries, who may come from this country, but some underprivileged neighborhoods, difficult situation here. If you have a dream, if you love something, simply never, never, never give up. You are going to succeed. You will overcome many difficulties. But if you have a goal, you will succeed. And I still get failures. My proposals for funding get rejected. My papers get rejected. I got paper rejected by Nature magazine just a couple of days ago. And I know it's a great science, and I'm going to fight to get it published here. But you should not stop here. Now, let me tell you a little bit about science we do, about science of two-dimensional materials, nanomaterials. It actually, to a large extent, started in 2004 with discovery made by other scientists, Andrew Guyman and Kostya Novoselov at the University of Manchester in UK, who showed that monatomic layers of graphene, basically materials made of single layer of atoms, invisible virtually here, have very unusual properties. They got a Nobel Prize in 2010 for it here. But what it did actually tell other scientists that it's possible to build materials which are like a sheet of papers but made of single atoms, which are thousands of times thinner than a sheet of paper, and use this material to build new materials and new technology. Now imagine, if you like to play with Lego bricks, and if you are given Lego bricks of one type, all of them blacks, all of them thin, you can do something, but it's not much fun. And now imagine, you can get Lego bricks of all possible colors, of all possible sizes. And this is largely what we did by discovering Maxine's. We showed that there are materials that are metallic and even more conducting, better conductors of electricity than graphene films, but they come in different colors, in different thicknesses. You can see, for example, red dots in this picture, those are single atoms. And we have one layer, two layers, three layers, four layers, five layers, nine layers, 11 layers. We can basically build new technology. We can make materials which have not been known before, which did not exist before. We can combine them, and we build entire devices by simply assembling those tiny layers into something much bigger, very useful. We can make new type of batteries. We can filter water and remove salt from water and give drinking water to people. We can make sensors which will sense, for example, contamination environment. We can make something else which will be useful. For example, deliver medicines here. And what we actually do, going from graphene to Maxine's, we're trying to solve useful problems. So what material scientists do, they discover materials. But the next step is find where those materials can be used. So what we're doing, we're trying to use these materials for energy generation, storing better batteries. Batteries that charge faster, store more energy. Desalinate water, make sensors that will sense spoilage of food, but also prevent degradation of food in packaging and make food stay good longer. We can clean air and desalinate or purify water. We can also deliver drug. For example, in my group, we're working on building artificial kidney using Maxine's, that we can save life of patients and improve quality of life patients who suffer from acute kidney disease. And of course, there are many other potential applications here. Also, we are trying to not only improve the current technology, we are trying to build future technologies. I don't know what your vision of the future technology is, but I see many technologies becoming flexible, wearable, connected in the Internet of Things, using renewable energy or harvesting energy from our movements, along with sun, wind, and other things here. So what we are trying to do is to use these two-dimensional materials to build flexible devices, incorporate devices into clothes that we wear every day here. So basically, take electronics from separate, large, bulky, mobile phones, computers, laptops, large screens into something that will be with us all the time here. Basically, the next world in technology. And those things are truly exciting because we feel we can make a difference here. But what is also important is that science is beautiful. I love chemistry, I love materials, I love science the same way I loved it when I was a high school kid. I'm equally excited with every discovery, every new material we make, every change in the material, every way to create a material, every new application here. And we're also trying to show the world the beauty of science running this non-orthography competition, when we show people pictures of the invisible world, colored, creative, and again, actually anyone can participate. Bring your picture, send it to non-orthography, and you may win a prize and see your pictures in calendar and online anywhere here. So I still continue following my dream of material discovery, of using chemistry to make materials that can improve technology, improve life, improve environment, improve health of people. And I wish all of you the same. Follow your dream, believe in yourself, and never, never, never give up. Thank you.